him up, pulls over the right shoulder. Officer walks up, sir, stop the career speed, I see your driver's license, registration, proof of insurance. Oh, by the way, I smell the odor of an alcoholic beverage, anything to drink tonight? Yeah, I've had a couple. Sir, why don't you step out of the vehicle for me? All 6'5", this guy steps out of the vehicle. Says, officer, with all due respect, my attorney told me not to answer your questions, not to take your field sobriety test, and I sure as heck ain't gonna blow into that magical box. Do we say have a nice day? Or do we have a duty and a responsibility to the voting public of the state of California to make sure he's okay to drive? Choice number two, what if he doesn't give us that opportunity? Then what do we do? That's exactly what we did. Took him to jail, took his pretty little Bentley to car jail, right? For 4 weeks, guys, he was drugged through the mud of the media until his toxicology report came back. 30 days later, guess what? Under the legal limit. Under the legal limit. All he had to do was let us do our job. Do we want to waste our time on you if you're not drunk? No, guys, here's DUI 101. Why is DUI a bad thing? Sometimes happen to good people. Because alcohol is a depressant. It numbs your senses and takes away your ability to make rational decisions. That's why we don't say don't drive drunk. We say don't drink and drive because you are affected the moment your lips touch that bottle can of cup. And parents are probably wondering why I'm up here talking about kids going to parties and drinking alcohol under the age of 21, right? Because we know that it exists, right? We're not going to stand here and pretend that it doesn't. If the teens take their first sip of alcohol prior to the age of 18, 65% more likely to become an alcoholic. And if you don't believe me, come to an Alcoholics Anonymous meeting with me. We're asking the question, Alcoholics Anonymous, how many of you guys have had your first sip of alcohol prior to the age of 18? How many raise your hand? All of them did. That's why they're there. And let's go across the hall to Narcotics Anonymous, where I asked them the very same question. Narcotics Anonymous, how many of you guys have had your first sip of alcohol prior to the age of 18? How many think raise your hand? All of them did. Narcotics Anonymous, how many of you guys got bored with the effects of alcohol and moved on to smoking weed? How many raise your hand? 100%. Narcotics Anonymous, how many of you guys got bored with the effects of weed and moved on to more hardcore illicit drugs? How many raise your hand? 100% did, and that's why they're there, guys. 100% of the time, it starts with underage drinking. See, teens, there's going to be a time and place in your life where you choose to consume alcohol. In none of your situations is that time and place right now. In none of your situations. Can you be arrested for driving in any equal to something besides alcohol? Yeah, you bet. What about prescription medication? Yeah, absolutely. Guys, I'm going to talk to you about three drugs that are a major epidemic. First one, no big surprise to you. Little green leafy something called marijuana. Back in the 60s and 70s, marijuana had a THC content between 2 and 3%. That's tetrahydrocannabolic oil and leaves get you high. Between 2 and 3% marijuana today, between 12 and 16%. We're not even talking about chronic. A THC content between 20 and 24%. Highs in some cases that are lasting for days. Teens, that euphoric feeling you feel when you're getting high, I don't care if you're drinking, slam it, huff it, puff it, or snort it, that euphoric feeling you feel when you're getting high is a process of you blowing brain cells right out of your ears. Two things the body will not reproduce, spinal fluid and brain cells. That's why we call it dope, because it doesn't make you stupid. And I know you're probably thinking, well, what about medicinal marijuana? I will concur, it has its place for the people that are suffering from anxiety, people that are going through chemotherapy, not the 18-year-old who thinks he has an eating disorder. If this was a rave party, teens, what kind of drugs would we see? Bobby, you know this one?
Can you repeat the question?
If this was a rave party, what kind of drug would we see?
I don't know.
Okay, that's a good answer, because your dad would want to know how you knew that. Ecstasy, right? If this is a rave party, it'd be pitch black in here. The teens that are high in ecstasy love the sensation of the strobe lights and the neon lights. If this is a rave party and teens were high in ecstasy, you'd see bodies piled all over each other. Why? The sensation of touching another human being for them is out of this world when they're high in ecstasy. And if this is a rave party and teens were high in ecstasy, you see these teens with their heads inside the speakers. We call them speaker tweakers. Because the sensation of the vibration of the music, again, out of this world for them. But this is why hundreds of teens are dying every year from the use of ecstasy. Because it's a hallucinogen that acts like a stimulant. Takes your resting pulse rate, guys, from 90 beats per minute to 165 plus beats per minute. Your core body temperature from 98 degrees to over 104 plus degrees. So your heart is exploding out of your chest, your body is cooking itself. What kind of prescription medications are popular right now? Anybody know? What's that?
Oxycodone,
Oxycontin, the big ones, right? And teens, where are you getting the prescription medications from? And I'm not talking about prescription from your doctor. Because you're hearing at school, the Oxycontin high is pretty insane. Lo and behold, you open your parents' medicine cabinet, happens to be a bottle of it. You take it out, you take it to school, pop a couple pills, give a couple to your friends. What you don't realize is you're putting the most addictive drug on the planet in your mouth. It's an opioid. And when you run out of that prescription medication, you're now physically addicted to it. Your body starts to ache and itch. Can you afford it on the street? No, because it goes for about 20 bucks a pop. Right? Then what happens? You go to TJ. Why? There's 30 pharmacies with 300 yards of the border. You buy three bottles, one to use, two to sell. And when you get caught by U.S. Customs coming back across the border, you can no longer go to Mexico to fill your habit. Then what happens? Switch to heroin. Why? It's cheaper and it's more accessible. Same high. So parents, I suggest you take all the prescription medications out of your medicine cabinet that you're not using, discard them appropriately. The ones that you are, make sure you lock them up. All right, I need a volunteer. Bobby, thank you for volunteering, buddy. Come on up, man. Yeah. This is the tasing portion. You go to the bathroom yet, Bobby? What? You go to the bathroom yet?
Did I go to the bathroom?
Yeah. Because when you taste, it has never mind. Just kidding, man. I'm not going to taste.
Yeah.
Oh, man. Getting older, that's not going to be easier. All right, Bobby, so you're 15. You got a high school yet?
Not yet.
Not yet? Soon?
I'm working on it.
What does that mean?
I could have my permit, but I'm still doing the online driving course.
Oh, okay, that's a good idea. All right. Because once you get your license, guess what happens? You're going to need me more often than you'd like. All right, so, Bobby, if you could drive any car on this planet, buddy, what would it be? Don't say Toyota Prius, please.
Not a Toyota Prius.
Don't say Toyota Prius. Any car that you want, either Bugatti dealership, right there, you got Bentley, Ferrari.
Maybe a Ferrari or Bentley.
Okay. Which one?
Bentley?
Okay. And what color?
Red.
You know cops see red really well, right, Bobby?
Blue.
Okay, blue. Blue's good. All right. So, Bobby, you're driving this brand new blue Bentley and up to the La Jolla High School. Let's say you're pulling up to Nautilus here. Every single good-looking girl in the high school is on the sidewalk watching you drive this blue Bentley, parking it on Nautilus. Show me what it looks like. Show me what it looks like when you're pulling up on Nautilus in a blue Bentley and all the good-looking girls are standing on the sidewalk watching you. You're standing up, right?
Driving, and I'm not looking at the pretty girls.
You're a bad liar, Bobby. I'm gonna let you be cool for a second because you have like the Easter Bunny in there for a second. You're gonna slouch down in your seat, okay? You're gonna be driving at 12 o'clock, right? And I guarantee you, if you're driving a Bentley, you probably got a girlfriend, okay? Alright, so that's probably what it looks like. Okay, so if Bobby goes headlight to headlight with another vehicle, is he going to be okay?
No.
No, if he goes headlight to headlight with another vehicle, does he go suddenly instantaneously forward this way? Or because he's slouched down in that seat, he slides into the lap belt, which catches on his ribcage and snaps his back? Choice number two, good guess. Guys, that seatbelt is designed for 3 points of contact, both sides of your hip and your collarbone. If you're slouched down in the seat, guess what? Nobody can see you anyway. So make sure that you're sitting correctly in the seat. So go ahead and sit up now. You're well educated, Bobby. All right, you're still driving with hands. All right. I noticed you dumped a girlfriend. We can talk about that later on. You're going to be driving at 12 o'clock, still looking cool. If Bobby gets in a collision where he goes headlight to headlight with another vehicle, is he going to be okay? No. You guys want to hear a gross story? Awesome. Fantastic news. So I respond to a head-on collision where a young man that caused the crash is in the back of the ambulance. I go to the back of the ambulance, open the ambulance doors. The paramedics say, "Officer, come here. We're having problems with this young man's obstructed airway. He's missing his top four teeth." So I go back to the vehicle. I'm looking for the teeth everywhere. I can't find them. I go back to the ambulance. "Officer Perry, don't worry about it. We found his top four teeth." Fantastic. Where did you find them? They were embedded in the left arm between his radius and ulna. This is what happened. He's driving at 12 o'clock. He's on a two-lane road. He goes to reach for something in the glove box. What he doesn't realize is the roadway curves off to the right just ahead as he's reaching for something in the glove box. He ends up on the wrong side of the road as a vehicle approaches from the opposite direction. Just prior to impact, his mouth is wide open because he's saying, "Oh, something or other," right? As the airbag deploys. How fast does the airbag deploy? 200 miles an hour. Takes his left arm and smacks him in the face, takes out his top four teeth. Do we drive at 12 o'clock? No, absolutely not. Do we drive at 10 and 2? Show me what 10 and 2 is, man. You need my digital watch?
Yeah.
10 and 2, there you go. All right, buddy. Do we drive at 10 and 2?
Yes.
Back in the old days, that's what the DMV used to tell you. Usually it's the parents that are saying yes. But you suffer from a disease called overcorrection when you're driving at 10 and 2. What does that mean? An object enters the roadway in front of you. You put a lot of steering input in to avoid that vehicle. Weight transfer takes over. Your vehicle starts to slide sideways. You try to counter steer and you put a lot of steering input into the opposite direction. Again, weight transfer takes over and your vehicle slides the opposite direction. Before you know it, your vehicle's doing 360s. So 10 and 2, not a good place. How about 9 and 3? Do we drive a 9 and 3? Your DMV instructors today will tell you, yes, 9 and 3. When that airbag deploys at 200 miles an hour, are you going to suffer second degree burns on the inside of your arms? Yeah, absolutely you are. Okay, so once you kick out that DMV instructor, when you're driving at 9 and 3, The very first video you saw of the highway patrolman that's sliding that patrol car around the S-curve, he was driving at 84. This is what happens. When he goes to enter the S-curve, he reaches up with his right hand. He begins to throttle modulate and feeds the steering wheel through his left hand. Causes the weight transfer to kick his vehicle out. He reaches up with his left hand as he enters the apex of the S-curve and feeds the steering wheel through his right hand again as he throttle modulates, causes the patrol car to come opposite direction. When he comes out of that S-curve, all he does is lets his grip off the steering wheel, lets the natural inertia of the vehicle straighten out the tire, and he slides right out of the S-curve. You can drive your vehicle from 8 and 4. Do me a favor. Don't go out there tonight to drive your vehicle at 8 and 4 and do this, because it doesn't work. All right? You got to feed the steering wheel through your hands. Everybody give Bobby a round of applause. Good job. What they have in common. The first story is Grandma and Grandpa are going to their grandson's first birthday party. Grandpa falls asleep at the wheel of a car, goes across double yellow lines, goes headlight to headlight with another vehicle. Medics arrive on scene. Grandpa's unresponsive, unconscious. Grandma is complaining of chest pain. Good news is they bring Grandpa back. Bad news is 3 to 5 minutes later, Grandma's unresponsive, unconscious, in full cardiac arrest, dies at the scene. Next story, 16-year-old young man gets a dirt bike for Christmas. Riding around a dirt road at 55 miles an hour to a gate that's typically open that happens to be closed. He hits that gate head on, flies over the gate, lands on his chest on an ascending embankment. Off-duty firefighter hears the collision, runs down, sets ceasefire precaution. Young man is complaining of chest pain. 3 to 5 minutes later, that young man's unresponsive, unconscious, in full cardiac arrest, dies at the scene. Next story. Teens, you won't remember this one. Parents, you probably will. Princess Di and Jodie Fayette are being chased by the paparazzi. They're in the best car money can buy. They're in a Mercedes, bulletproof glass, airbags everywhere. The driver enters the tunnel at 90 miles an hour, hits a puddle, loses coefficient of friction, and topples that Mercedes around the bridge abutment. Medics arrive on scene. Princess Di is complaining of chest pain. They scoop her up on the way to the hospital. She's unresponsive, unconscious, in full cardiac arrest, dies at the hospital. What do all three of those stories have in common?
Chest pain,
that's right. There's three collisions in every collisions, guys. Vehicle into the object. You into something inside the vehicle, and this is the one that gets you. Your seatbelt holds your skeletal structure in place, but your body doesn't have the ability to stop suddenly and instantaneously. In this case, your heart goes forward, your aorta rips, and you bleed out. We call it aorta deviation. Let's talk about projectiles real quick. Bobby, if I were to take you out of your blue Bentley, right, sit you up against the wall, take a hard object out of your Bentley and throw it at you as hard as I could I hurt you with it?
Yes.
Yeah, work out, man. Of course, right? In a collision where weight times speed squared equal force, could that object potentially kill you?
Yeah.
Yes, you bet. Young lady's driving down the roadway at 55 miles an hour, she's texting. She doesn't realize the traffic ahead of her, complete stop. She rear-ends the back of those vehicles without ever hitting the brakes. Good news is, everybody walked away. Bad news is, her 7-year-old in the right rear seat was hit by a rollerblade from the back of the car, hit him in the head, put him in a coma. He survived, that's the good news. Can a human be a projectile? 4 seatbelts, 5 occupants, let's watch this video real quick. Hazard. He begins to make the left turn, winging his broadsided by the truck. The impact is so severe it causes the truck to overturn and the Mustang to wrap around this pole. Can you guys see this sign right here? What does that indicate?
Bus stop,
right? Anybody want to guess what's underneath the Mustang? Bus bench. One of the witnesses to this collision was the bus driver pulling away from this curb as the accident goes down, who had just picked up 3 passengers from that bus bench. Do your actions just affect you? No, they don't. This very easily could have been a quadruple fatal. The toxicology report comes back on the driver of the Mustang positive for THC. What was he doing on his lunch break? Smoking weed. That's right. Jason Dudley comes from a very prominent family in East County, Dudley Construction, multi-million-dollar construction company. Jason, by his junior year, has never had anything less than an A. Jason takes the SATs, he's got a nearly perfect score, academic scholarship to Cal Poly San Luis Obispo for structural engineering, backup acceptance to San Diego State University. Jason decides the end of his junior year, you know what, I've been working hard my entire life, I'm going to take my senior year off. Matter of fact, I'm going to go ahead and go to my party the summer before my senior year, which Jason does what for the very first time? Consumes alcohol, that's right. Jason gets so addicted to the feeling of getting drunk that as his senior year starts, he can no longer wait for the weekend parties to get drunk. He makes a concoction at school called Faderade, where he's mixing vodka and Gatorade, and he's drinking it throughout the school day. By Christmas vacation, Jason is bored with the effects of alcohol and starts smoking weed. By spring break, Jason is bored with the effects of weed and starts snorting cocaine. Jason fails his second semester senior English class. What does Cal Poly San Luis Obispo do? That's right. Rejects not only a scholarship, but can you go to a 4-year university with a failed second semester senior English class? No. Jason thought he was going to go to San Diego State, stay local, and party with his friends. Jason, the summer after his senior year, is going to the Olive Garden with his girlfriend. What kind of food does the Olive Garden serve? Italian food. What kind of alcohol goes good with Italian food? Yeah, wine. That's right. Jason's 18 years old. Can he legally purchase wine at the Olive Garden? No, but he can go across the street to Longstroke and steal a bottle, which he does. Comes back to the parking lot of the Olive Garden, pours that wine into a Tupperware container, goes into the Olive Garden, starts drinking it, orders his food, thinks it's hilarious because he's doing this right next to 2 La Mesa PD officers who are in there having dinner. Thinks it's even funnier, decides to take off and not pay the check. Jason jumps in his lowered Audi A4, enters the 125 freeway. He needs to exit at Fletcher Parkway to go to Albertson's to steal more wine. Jason is unrestrained. Jason is intoxicated. The driver's side window of Jason's vehicle is rolled down and Jason's left elbow is sitting outside the vehicle. Jason is going to enter this decreasing ascending cloverleaf off-ramp. Can you guys see the suggested speed? 20 miles an hour. Anybody want to guess how fast Jason exited? 90 miles an hour. Loses control of the vehicle as he misses his apex. He begins to understeer. What does that mean? That means his tires are facing to the right, but the natural inertia of the vehicle are carrying him straight and right towards this concrete wall. Jason, you can see Jason's left tire scrub right here on the wall. This is a 4.5-foot tall wall. Jason's left elbow is hanging out the driver's side window. What happens to his left elbow upon impact? It explodes. Jason is unrestrained. Does he get ejected into the wall or over the wall? Jason gets ejected into the wall. Can you guys see these little reflectors right here? The plastic flange is secured by metal bases. The metal base here is still here, but the plastic flange is missing. I'm going to show you why. That's Jason's Audi after the impact. It was actually an angular impact, and those walls are designed for that. A lot of damage, mainly to the undercarriage portion. The reason why that plastic flange is missing in the next slide I'm going to show you is extremely graphic, so prepare yourself. Because Jason's face took it off. You can actually see the perfect incision from the metal base on the right side of Jason's face. This was right after surgery where they just retrieved Jason's left eye. That's the x-ray of Jason's skull where it took multiple metal plates to reconstruct his face. That's Jason post-surgery. And that's Jason with some of the swelling that had come down. I met this young man for the very first time at our Ember 15 Minutes program. He's actually one of our speakers. Jason had the world by the tail swinging over his head, and the parents never in a million years thought he'd end up down this path. A straight-A student his entire life. Jason does a lot of speaking for us, and teens, if he were here tonight, there would be tears running down his face, even though it's been 5 years since this crash went down. There'd be tears running down his face, and he would beg and plead with you not to take the same path that he did, because he will absolutely 100% contribute this path to that first party in and persons with alcohol. So, all right, we're almost done, guys, so hang in there. Let's talk about seatbelts real quick. California's doing awesome, right? We've got a 97% compliance rating. Here's the bad news. Guys, 50% of our fatalities involve somebody who is wearing their seatbelt improperly or not wearing their seatbelt at all. If you're driving down the roadway with that seatbelt tucked underneath your arm, can you get a citation? Yeah, improperly worn, absolutely. Two young brothers, they go to dinner together. They finish dinner, they leave, give each other a hug. One makes it home, one doesn't. Truck driver driving down the roadway the very next morning sees a silver Mercedes into a pepper tree. Gets out, opens the driver's side door, sees a young man slumped over the center console dead. This is what happens. The young man drifts off the roadway, goes head on with that pepper tree, not wearing his seatbelt. He goes suddenly and instantaneously forward. How do we know he's not wearing a seatbelt? Hair follicles in the windshield, glass particles in his forehead. As he goes forward, how fast does that airbag deploy? 200 miles an hour. Hits him in the chest, blows him back, breaks his seat back, falls over the center console, dead instantaneously. Coroner's report comes back, cause of death, aorta deviation. Tachometer and speedometer are frozen in place, which indicate his speed upon impact. Anybody want to guess how fast he was going when he hit that tree? 36 miles an hour. 36 miles an hour. Guys, that airbag is designed to be used in conjunction with your seatbelt. That's why they call it a supplementary restraint system. If you're not wearing your seatbelt, that airbag can't hurt you, if not kill you. All right, in this video, you're going to see a taxi cab driver not wearing his seatbelt, falls asleep at the wheel of a car, hits a brick retaining wall and overturns. Do me a favor, don't get into a taxi with a guy wearing a Dale Earnhardt shirt, because I guarantee you he doesn't know how to drive. Watch what happens.
So, your seat good? If the mirror's all adjusted, you can see everything okay? Just stay off the freeways, all right? I don't want you going out on those yet. Just leave your phone and your purse. I don't want you texting.
Daddy, okay.
Okay. There you go. Be careful.
Thanks, Dad.
Call me, they're not white driving. We knew this day was coming. That's why we bought a Subaru.
No, the highway patrol is not supporting Subaru. Parents, is that what we see when our teens get behind the wheel of a car? I know when my daughter first got behind the wheel of a car, that's certainly what I saw. Teens, driving is a privilege, driving is not a right. Driving is a huge responsibility, and you're acting irresponsible in any aspects of your life. You have absolutely no business being behind the wheel of a car. Parents, let me ask you a question. Where do your teens get 99% of their driving actions, attitudes, and behaviors from? Uh-oh. Yeah. So parents, when you're texting, when you're speeding, when you're following too closely, what are your teens more than likely going to do when they get behind the wheel of a car? The exact same thing. Teens, if this hasn't happened to you yet, it will. You're going to be driving out in the middle of nowhere, a two-lane road, approaching an uncontrolled intersection. You're going to be probably about a quarter mile away. There's going to be a vehicle approaching that intersection, also about a quarter mile away. Your parents are going to be in the right front seat. The very moment that your parent sees that vehicle approaching the intersection, they're going to go, "Hey, look out!" Right? And you're going to do that. You're going to go hard right, you're going to go hard left, and you're going to crash, right? So parents, do me a favor. Be very diplomatic in your approach with your constructive criticism. Teens, for the first time in your life, and probably the only time in your life, your parents are going to know what they're talking about. So be receptive to that constructive criticism. All right, teens, this is the license that you have. If you don't have it, you will. That's what it looks like. What do the red and blue indicate? 18 or 21, why do we have that? Because the bouncers at the bar are too stupid to calculate your birthday. Provisions, just kidding. Provisions are on the back. What are they? Guess what? You may not talk on the cell phone or text. When do you get to talk on the cell phone? When you're 18 and you have a Bluetooth in your ear. Based on what I said earlier, do you want to be really doing that anyway? No, absolutely not. When do you get to text? Never, ever, ever. If that phone is in your hand and you're using it in any capacity, teen or parent, you're going to receive a citation. For the first year of your driver's license, you may not drive between the hours of 11 p.m. or 5 a.m. Why? Because you have no business driving between the hours of 11 p.m. or 5 a.m. And FYI, 13% of teen fatalities occur during this time. If I stop you at 11:15 at night coming from work at Pizza Port with your Pizza Port t-shirt on and pizza sauce all over the front of your shirt, are you going to get in trouble? No, probably not. If you tell me that you're coming from work at Pizza Port in high heels and a mini skirt, are you going to get in trouble? Yes, especially if you're a dude. All right. You may not transport passengers under the age of 25 unless accompanied by a parent or guardian who possesses a valid California driver's license. Parents, do me a favor. Don't use your teens as a designated driver, okay? Can Johnny take Sister Susie to school?
Yeah.
If they go to the same school, what if they go to different schools?
No.
No. Unless, parent, you've exhausted all means to get that sibling to the school and there's a letter from you indicating the reason. Can Johnny take Sister Susie to a medical appointment?
Yeah.
No, parent, unless you've exhausted all means to get that sibling to the medical appointment and there's a letter from you. Don't let me catch you northbound on the 5 with two dirt bikes in the back of your truck with your brother in the right front seat and a letter from your parent saying that you're going to a dentist appointment in San Diego because you're going to get a citation. And teens, who gets to go to court with you when you're under the age? Your parents. Do you think your parents are going to be happy about that? No, they're not. All right, why do we have these provisions? Because 65% of teen passenger deaths occur when another teen is driving. Look at these numbers, guys. 16-year-olds carrying one passenger were 39% more likely to be killed than if they were driving alone. 86% with two passengers, 182% with three passengers. Are 17-year-olds any better?
No.
Why?
Smart out.
Yes. Smart Alex. After the first year of driving, they think they're really good at driving, right? But here's the big one. After the first year of driving, what's the provision that gets lifted? They now can take passengers. You got peer pressure, showing off for friends, distracted driving, all the things that are killing these kids. All right, last slide. Civil liability teams. Why am I going to talk to you about civil liability? Because congratulations, you live in California where 8 out of 10 civil lawsuits filed in the U.S. are filed right here. Welcome. All right? Teens, if you make a mistake under the age of 18, behind the wheel of a car, who's going to be civilly liable? Your parents. When you're 18 years old, you live at home, and you're considered a dependent, that vehicle's registered, co-signed, or insured by your parent according to case law, who's civilly liable? Parents, when you're off to college at 21, you're considered a dependent that equals registered cosigner insured by your parent. Who's civilly liable? Your parents. You think your parents had to work hard for everything they have in their life? Absolutely. You think your one mistake can wipe them completely free of all those things they've worked really hard for? You bet. So parents, I suggest you go home, do exactly what I did, calculate exactly what you're worth, make sure you have an umbrella policy to cover that work. All right? The good news is, guess what? Bus passes are available. Yeah, I tried that on my daughter. It didn't work. I offered her a bus pass rather than driving. She wasn't happy. Guys, follow these five rules. I promise you'll never be in a crash. It was your fault. Matter of fact, you'll be able to perceive and predict 90% of the crashes that would not have been your fault. Here they are. First one is, slow down. That's easy, right? Back off. Guys, these comprise 90% of our crashes. Remember? Maximize lateral space cushion. What does that mean? Do not drive down the freeway with the vehicle to the front, to the rear, to the left, and to the right of you. Make sure you have an escape route. High visual horizon. What does that mean? Look as far ahead as you possibly can. This is where you'll be able to perceive and predict the actions of the drivers ahead of you. If you've ever been northbound on the 5 around 4 o'clock near Via de la Valle, Dollar Heights, if you're looking down, you're more than likely going to rear into the cars that are stopping at the bottom of the hill. You got to look as far up as you possibly can. And the last one is backing up. It's your responsibility to check your mirrors and look over your shoulder. Questions? It is not easy to sit here for an hour and a half and listen to a guy in uniform talk, but you guys did an awesome job. I appreciate your attention. Have a good night. All right. Thank you.